Hello everyone and welcome to another Recommends video. In this video, we will be doing The Darkling Plain by Philip Reeve. It is the fourth and final novel in the Immortal Engines series. A link to the playlist that has the first three novels will be in the upper right corner. This novel was published in 2006 and the story takes place 6 months after the events in the last novel, Infernal Devices. Before we begin, consider subscribing, giving us a like, dropping us a comment, and now let's begin the story. Theo Angoni is back home. He's been back home for 6 months. General Naga, who's now the leader of the Green Storm, now that Stalker Fang is gone, have made a truce with the Traction Cities and have sent a delegation led by his wife, Lady Naga, to Zagwa to have talks with them. Theo was in his kite flying below the cloud cities when he noticed some cast crew of super gnats heading towards Zagwa. He could see the rockets underneath the gondolas and he could tell that they were going to attack the city where the talks were taking place. With his kite, he was able to land on the top of the trailing airship. When one of the crew members came up to take a look, he managed to knock her out and get in and tie her up. He managed to take control of the airship by forcing the pilot to one side and warn Zagwa of the upcoming attack. That's when the pilot attacked him and stabbed him several times. He passed out from blood loss just as the anti-aircraft guns did their job. Meanwhile, Tom and his daughter Ren are in the city with the Jenny Hanover, and he has just been examined by a doctor who told him that at best he has 5 years left to live if he takes things easy, or he could be dead within a year if he doesn't. He's teaching his daughter to be an aviatrix so that when he dies, she'd be able to take over the Jenny Hanover and make a living for herself. As he left the doctor walking back to the Jenny Hanover, he saw someone he recognized that he hasn't seen since his days in London, Clytie Potts. But she was supposed to have died in London when the Medusa blew up the city. So he chases after her, happy and excited to see her. And when he does catch up to her while she was boarding her ship, she tells him he's mistaken, that her name is Charisma Chard, the mistress of the ship, and she doesn't know anybody from London. He apologizes and leaves, and when he gets back to the Jenny Hanover, he speaks to Ren, first downplaying the seriousness of his illness, and second, telling her about meeting Clytie Potts. Ren suggests that they go and investigate to find out if she was telling the truth. So they headed to Pondicherry's old tech auction rooms to ask him some questions. Ren bribes the proprietor with an ancient mobile phone to get some information. All they got from him was that she picked up a Kliss coil, and they're not sure what she wants the Kliss coils for. So Ren suggested to Tom that they could go east trying to follow her and go to Airhaven, where they can look at the registration bureau to see if they can find any more information about her and her ship. So they headed east in their ship trying to find Clytie Potts. Theo was only able to survive his knife wound because of Lady Naga, who operated on him. After he had healed from his injuries, Air Marshal Cora and Lady Naga came to see him. They believe that the attack was not aimed at Zagwa, but aimed at killing Lady Naga, because she's the one that has convinced her husband, General Naga, to pursue peace talks. And there are elements in the Green Storm that don't want those peace talks, so they're trying to assassinate her. To keep her safe, they're going to sneak her out of Zagwa in a Zagwan trading ship that is headed to Shangao. And Theo will be the captain of that ship. The ship he and Lady Naga would be traveling in is called the Nzimu. There will be four people traveling together: Lady Naga, Captain Rasputra, who is her bodyguard, and her servant Rohini, along with Theo. Fishcake is in Cairo's lower depths in its drains. That's where he is rebuilding Stalker Fang. He goes up into the city, steals the parts he needs, and comes back to repair her. Stalker Fang's personality alternates between the original Anna, who at times when it comes up begs Fishcake to kill her, and the new Stalker personality that is intent on going to Shangao. Fishcake has a plan of how to get to Shangao. Apparently Cairo is going to be trading with Brighton very soon. So when it does, Fishcake and Stalker Fang will sneak over onto Brighton and steal one of the limpets. The one thing that Fishcake is determined not to get for Stalker Fang is eyes, because as long as she doesn't have eyes, she can't leave him. While the Inzimu traveled over the desert, piloted by Captain Rosputa, something about Rohini bothered Theo. And while he was thinking about it, Rohini, meanwhile, was with Lady Naga, beginning to brush her hair. That was when she put a belt around Lady Naga's neck and began to squeeze in an attempt to kill her. Right about then, Theo woke up, realizing that the airship had altered course. So he went to ask Captain Rasputra what was going on, but he couldn't because somebody had cut Captain Rasputra's throat. He grabbed a fire axe and ran to Lady Naga's room and smashed down the door. Inside, he saw Rohini strangling Lady Naga, and he recognized her through her disguise. It was Cynthia Twite. He distracted Cynthia by getting her to tell him what her plan is. Their plan is to assassinate Lady Naga because she's the one that convinces General Naga to hold peace talks with all of the traction cities. She's also confident that Stalker Fang will return to lead them. She then kicked Theo down and grabbed the axe from him and left, saying that there's a bomb on the ship set to blow at midnight. So she took off in one of the Zagwan kites. He had just reached Lady Naga when the bomb in the ship exploded. The Brighton, which was now a floating wreck and was controlled by the Lost Boys, still got tourists, although it was tourists that was willing to risk their lives. Fishcake and Stalker Fang went on to the Brighton as tourists, the goal being to steal a limpet. But one of the Lost Boys, Brittle Star, noticed them and he came with his gang to try and kill Fishcake. But it was Brittle Star and his entire gang that ended up getting killed by Stalker Fang. Fishcake and Stalker Fang then went into a limpet and left. Tom and Ren reach the Traction Stadt Jishel shaft, which is 12 large traction cities that got together to fight the Green Storm, and managed to fight them to a stalemate. The city that Tom and Ren was headed for was Airhaven. We had gotten just a little bit of information when they ran into Ola Thrumbly, who Ren knew from Cloud Nine. She gave them a little bit more information, but then pointed them to Penny Royal, whom he actually knew Marchard. So she took them to meet him. So down into the city of Murnau they went. They met with Penny Royal in a place called Moons. They asked him about Kure's Marchard, and he told them that he met her 20 years ago for the first time. She was looking to buy an airship that she paid for with London gold. She claimed that she got the gold when she was in London after it got destroyed. He said she also claimed that London was haunted. Tom, of course, immediately told them that her real name is Clytie Potts and that she was a historian in London. And he thinks that maybe she's using her airship to fly in supplies to the survivors of London. Of course, nobody believed that story. While Ren's father, Tom, was speaking to Penny Royal, a young man came to speak to her. He was the son of Kreitzmarschall von Kobold. His name was Wolf Kobold, and he invited them to a party so he can speak to them about this a little more. Meanwhile, Theo and Lady Naga, after their ship crashed, were rescued by Grandma Gravy, who promptly made them slaves and sold them to Napster Varley, master of the humbug. Meanwhile, Hester Shaw and Shrike was in the same area. Shrike had rescued Hester and found a doctor for her who nursed her back to health. And since Shrike couldn't kill because his mind was tampered with, Hester did the killing. And she was able to use the money that she made killing to buy a sand ship and guns. And the two of them became legends of the deep sands. She, a bounty hunter, and the Stalker, who was her companion. Hester was known as the Black Angel. Theo saw her and called out to her. She was all prepared to leave him, but Shrike demanded that she save him. So she rescued Theo while killing a whole bunch of people in the process. But Napster Varley still had Lady Naga in his hold, and they didn't know that. Ren and Tom went to the party, and they saw Wolf Cobalt privately. It turns out he had been to the ruins of London, and he was positive there was someone living deep in the ruins, probably building some new type of technology. And he made a proposal that Ren and Tom go with him to the ruins of London. Theo, Hester and Shrike were in their sand ship, but they realized they were being chased by six other sand ships belonging to Grandma Gravy. They were able to take out three of the ships chasing them. One of the other ships got close to them and men boarded, and it was hand-to-hand fighting. With Theo's help, they managed to repel the boarders and continue on their way. Theo saw beneath Hester's gruff exterior and knew she was a kind person underneath. He then told Shrike and Hester that Ononi Zero is Lady Naga and that she was sold to Varley. Shrike and Theo wanted to go after Lady Naga and rescue her. Hester didn't, but eventually she gave in. While Wolf went ahead to his traction town of Harrowbarrow, Ren and Tom prepped the Jenny Hanover and got her ready and followed him to meet up at Harrowbarrow. Meanwhile, Cynthia, still in the guise of Ruhini, reaches General Naga and tells him that his wife is dead. She is hoping that he will restart the war, but he refuses because he thinks that his wife, Lady Naga, did not want war. She would want peace, so he's going to continue with the peace. So Cynthia decides she's going to have to help him the way she helped Lady Naga. Meanwhile, Ren and Tom in the Jenny Hanover reach the area where they're supposed to rendezvous with the Harrowbarrow, but they didn't see it until they see the Harrowbarrow coming up out of the ground. It was a city designed to dig beneath the mud, loose shale, and sand and silt and travel that way. Once it came up, a landing pad was extended out and a Jenny Hanover landed. Wolf took them to eat and it soon became clear that he wanted things to go back to the way they were. Meanwhile, Fishcake and Stalker Fang used the limpet they had stolen to travel underwater through rivers and seas to get all the way to the low flanks of the Zanshan Mountains. Once they could go no further, they left the limpet and began to walk. Stalker Fang led them to a small hut where a lady named Satya lived, and that's when the Anna persona took over. They stayed with Satya for a while until the Anna persona decided that she had to find Dr. Papjoy and maybe he can kill the Stalker Fang's persona. The Anna persona did not know what the Stalker Fang persona wanted. Fishcake said that the Stalker Fang persona wanted to find something called Odin. The Harrowbarrow came up just at the Green Storm lines and used the attack as a diversion to launch the Jenny Hanover, which carried Wolf, Tom and Ren towards the London wreck. After days of travel, they finally got to the outskirts of the ruins of London. There, the three of them marched into the ruins and Tom began shouting, "Hello, hello." And they were promptly surrounded by a group of young people with crossbows and captured. They were let down into the ruins, passing the airship that Miss Potts uses. Finally, they came to a section where there was a lot of people living. Finally, they were led before the committee, which included the Lord Mayor of London, Chudley Pomeroy, and Clytie Potts. Pomeroy and the committee then explained how they survived the destruction of London by going deep into the bowels of the city. Anytime any of them tried to leave, they'd be killed, so they decided to stay and continue living there. A few of the committee let slip that they are working on some new technology. That's when Pomeroy informed them they can never be allowed to leave. Stalker Fang and Fishcake went to the villa where Dr. Papjoy lived, killed all of his guards, and then Papjoy, who was intrigued that Stalker Fang was back, explained that the brain that he used to connect to Anna Fang's brain was a special one that was found on an island close to the top of the world, and it was obviously from a society that had invented the Stalkers, but these Stalkers were for remembering, not for killing. So he happily repaired Stalker Fang's brain, and then for his trouble, Stalker Fang promptly killed him. Meanwhile, in London, it turns out Clytie Potts is actually Clytie Flint, who is married to an engineer named Lupak Flint. Tom, Wolf, and Wren are guarded but not very well, and one night Wolf sneaks out to take a look around, and of course Wren follows him. She catches up with him, and together they sneak down further down into the city, and they found one place where the engineers was working on a special project, and of course they got caught. Clytie comes and gets Tom, telling him that Wren and Wolf were caught spying, so they take him and bring him down to them. They also show him what they were working on. They're working on a new city, a small one, but it is built to use maglev engines so that it could float on the magnetic field of the Earth and go anywhere it wants. When Wolf learns this info, he escapes. Wren and Angie caught up with Wolf. He knocked Angie out and then proceeded to tell Wren that he will take the new technology and rebuild a harrow barrow to make it the most powerful predator city in the world. When she heard what he planned to do, she screamed for help, but by the time they came, he was gone. Meanwhile, Napster Varley has brought Ononi Zero to Manchester to try and sell her. He knew that she is the Lady Naga and figured he could get some money for her. But everybody he tries to reach out to ignores him. Meanwhile, Hester found an airship that she bought that she called the Shadow Aspect. And she, Theo, and Shrike came along to the Traction-style Gesellschaft, which is all the cities along the front with the Green Storm. Some of the mayors of those cities wanted to restart the war, especially Adley Brown, who was in charge of Manchester. They think that the Green Storm is now weak and that's why they're suing for peace. Meanwhile, Hester brought her ship up to the air haven, which is floating above the cities. She leaves Shrike on the ship to hide while she and Theo went out into air haven to get as much information as they could on the whereabouts of Napster Varley. They find Varley and try to buy Zero from him, but he asks too much money that they don't have. As she and Theo walk away, they run into someone who Hester thinks can get them a lot of money, enough to buy Zero. Meanwhile, Van Cobalt takes a closer look at the picture that Varley gave him and does indeed recognize that it is Lady Naga. So he leaves the conference and heads up to Airhaven. At the same time, Hester recognizes Pennyroyal, who was down on his luck, and she and Theo quickly follows him and meets with him in his rooms, where he tells her that Tom and Wren are just left to go do a job for Wolf Cobalt. He also shows her a newspaper article that outs him as a fraud. Hester takes what's left of Pennyroyal's money, but Theo lets slip as he leaves that Lady Naga is still alive, which gives Pennyroyal the idea that if he captures Lady Naga and gives her to the Traction Cities, he will once again regain his fame and fortune. Hester sends Theo back to her ship to get it ready while she go alone to rescue Lady Naga. When Theo gets back to the ship, he tells Shrike, and Shrike is determined to go and help her, although if he is caught, he would be destroyed because he can no longer kill. Hester reaches Varley, and with Pennyroyal's money, she tries to buy Lady Naga. Meanwhile, Pennyroyal has gathered up some roughs and is taking them down to Varley's ship in order to take Lady Naga from Varley himself so that he could regain his fame and fortune. Hester gets into a fight with Varley and his men in an attempt to free Lady Naga, but when something hits her in the head, she's at a disadvantage, and Varley was about to kill her when his wife, who he continually beats, killed him. Just as Ononi and Hester were leaving, Van Cobalt shows up and tells them they're not going to escape without his help. Then Pennyroyal and his thugs show up and a fight ensues. They shoot Van Cobalt, and that's when Shrike came up from under the floorboards to get them. He grabs Hester and Ononi and jumps towards the Shadow Aspect that Theo had just brought alongside. Now, with Shrike and Hester and Ononi on the Shadow Aspect, they drop it down into the clouds below Airhaven to hide. While all this is happening, Pennyroyal, who by now his thugs think that he led them to a stalker, turn on him, and he begins to fight with one of the reporters that followed him. And in the ensuing chaos, they both fall off the edge of Airhaven. On the Shadow Aspect, Ononi is tending to Hester's wound while they try to escape. And that's the end of part one. Part two will be in an upcoming video. I'd like to thank you for watching and listening. Please give us a like, drop us a comment, and subscribe if you haven't. And I will see you in the next video.